we came to you because we figured who better to tell us how to save the world?
Right. You're gonna start like that.
is there a way to save theatrical? Is it all over? Is the entire thing finished?
Well, you know, like you could be in danger. I mean, I think you could have a self-fulfilling prophecy.
It does become that after a while, doesn't it?
It's not whether it has to happen or there's a natural evolution of things. It's you can cause things to fail.
And do you think that it's conscious on the part of the studios that they want to narrow this and make theatrical kind of more of a side business?
No, actually, I don't think it has anything to do with studios. Huh. I think it has to do with corporations. The studios don't exist anymore. Studios are the pawns, and they're being served up, and they're doing their jobs and defending it. Because mm-hmm. why in any kind of anybody in a rightful mind would damage, you know, the engine of the whole thing? But the corporations are cable companies, they're satellite companies, they're widget companies. You know, mm-hmm. everybody's something other than a movie, you know, purely content provider.
So they don't, because it doesn't really affect their, or they don't want it to affect their stock price?
Well, I don't think they've looked at it. I think they're looking at their future business and saying, what's the next thing for me to get into? If I'm a cable company, then how do I monetize the internet? How do I use my cable, you know, to become more important, take a larger chunk? How do I make more machines? You know, how do I make, you know, whatever, you know, manufacture whatever somebody needs on their setup or on their computers or new computers or new, you know, whatever they're doing, somebody wants, has a secondary purpose. And nobody in the primary purpose of the movie, then when you come downstream to where do you exist, because movies now aren't the engine. They're, when you go into corporations, they're, in almost every one of those companies, a fairly small division, a smaller division of pretty big corporations. They're not fighting hard enough to say, wait a minute, if I'm Comcast and I just bought Universal for whatever $1 billion, the studio is $8, $10, whatever billion, I don't know what the valuation is, but pretty sizable chunk. You're now, for a few $100 million, you're jeopardizing billions of dollars. Because right now, if you said theatrical is what, half the size of worldwide, and worldwide base half the size of video,
right?
So, you know, your 20% of your revenue comes out of theatrical, and 50% or 45% comes out of theatrical, and the other 45-50% comes out of video. I think it's like 1% comes out of VOD.
Right.
So, and if you say, okay, you know, but clearly there's a movement in that direction, and it'll change. So in the next 5 years, it'll go to 5%.
Right.
In the next 10 years, maybe it goes to 10%. You know, there's no reason why it will, but...
Well, it's never really taken. I mean, VOD, when it was called PPV, just never really became something people were interested in, even at $4 a pop, much less $30 a pop.
Well, there's studies done on this, which is too much choice is no choice at all. So the more things you throw at somebody, the harder it is for anybody to make a decision, right? And on movies, when you make people make a specific buy decision, you know, like that's why subscription television works so well, because they don't look at it. I'm buying Game of Thrones.
Right.
No, I'm buying HBO. You know, or even video. You know, I'm subscribing to Netflix now.
Right.
You know, so I'm paying $7 a month. I'm not paying $7 for this one movie that I really wanted to see.
Right.
Now you're saying buy this, which has never worked.
Well, except in actually getting people to go to the movie theater.
Right.
Ironically.
Yes.
The one time it works.
Well, because you're directing people in for something very specific, and then there's a sense of discovery of being first, and then it's word of mouth. So the danger to the whole process, and beyond, there's a lot of dangers, but danger to the process is it becomes, which it already is headed in a bad direction. Anyways, it becomes a business of the few.
Right.
Few movies. What movies, if I don't know anything about anything, what am I going to pick? I'm not picking Black Swan.
Right.
I'm not picking Fighter. I'm not picking True Grit. You know, I'm not picking any of those movies. I might pick Inceptions because they spent so much money to make it and market it.
Right.
Which would have been a good choice. Otherwise, I'm just picking name brands because I don't know what this movie is, but I know the name.
Right.
So the direction the studios are already moving in, which is a business of few movies, will become accentuated by leaps and bounds. Just so there won't be room for anything else.
Well, also, I would say that if the business is constricted, if the theatrical business is constricted by 10, 20, 30%, then eventually the theaters, most of them have to go to business, no?
Right. It doesn't take much to take that business down into a non-business.
Right.
Or certainly they're not going to keep doing what they've done over the last few years, because if you said, who's run their business well over the last 5 years?
Mm-hmm.
Not studios.
Right.
Not manufacturing companies. Who's run it really well? Theaters. The video companies have done terrible jobs, you know. The studios basically helped ruin home video.
Right.
And so who's done a really good job? The theaters have rebuilt themselves. They've digitalized. They went to 3D. They improved the sound systems. They improved the seating, you know, tiered seating. Everything has been actually about improving that experience. Mm-hmm. And so who's taking a shot in the against the bow? It's the theaters.
Well, ironically, I got the impression from reading Jim Giannopoulos' comments in the New York Times that they, because he's kind of speaking for them unofficially, but that, you know, there's a sense that theatrical is so stable that it can't be rocked. I mean, they were talking about it like, okay, that money is there in the pile and it's not going to be affected by whatever we do, so let's keep on pushing the post-theatrical in whatever way we want, because we're somehow safe in theatrical.
No, that's not true. If you went even historically, if you said,
well,
okay.
Well, not true, but do you think he thinks that? Do you think they
no,
think
I
that?
Think that's something to say. I think okay. That's a defense. I mean, if you're if you're telling somebody to, you know, you're going to be executed tomorrow,
right,
and there's going to be a gun pointing at your forehead, then you're going to have problems.
Yeah.
If you say there's no problem, you don't worry about tomorrow, then you get to lure them into the execution without problems. So, mm-hmm. I actually think that's the proper thing for him to do. I don't think it's necessarily what the case is. If you look at, again, historically what's happened, you know, because theatrical was the only business,
right,
60 years ago. You know, it's 90-something percent of all leisure time activities.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's radio comes in, and television comes in, and video comes in, and cable comes in, and mm-hmm. internet comes in. In each one of those things, you could actually look and see what it does to attendance, which
right.
drops it. It doesn't kill it. That's
right.
the beauty of the business model is it has some elasticity to it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you take it down too much, then there's nothing in the front, especially if you're not the sole reason to exist, which is you're the first market in, you're a different experience, you're cultural, you're part of the culture.
Right.
If you take those things away, then you're doing replacement economics, and the business model goes away. All those subsequent markets disappear.
Right.
Theatricals lessen, which means that you might lose theaters, but the other ones will go away.
Hmm. So what do you think that they are really thinking?
I don't know. I don't understand it. I understand that there's two things that go on. One is there's a corporate imperative, which is mm-hmm. to say this is the agenda of the corporation, not necessarily the agenda of the movie company, and I don't know that the movie companies have what voice they have in that mm-hmm. whole decision making. And then second is, it's sort of, I guess my metaphor for it would be, or analogy would be, that it's like your next door neighbor has the flu and he got pneumonia and he died, and so you go and you catch the flu and you shoot yourself because you say, I'm gonna die, so
right.
Let me do it quickly. And mm-hmm. and the patient in this case is music, which killed themselves.
Right.
And the internet and digital completely destroyed the business model without the music industry figuring out how to at least make it work for them, particularly.
Right.
The movie business is way different than music business. You know, when I walked in the first time and heard digital music, you have to change from vinyl to CDs.
Right.
When you could go on the internet, you'd pick any song anywhere in the world, it was great. Actually, even on my iPod now, it starts to run into problems because I have too many songs, you know, mm-hmm. too many things. It's not the same thing as flipping through your albums or your CDs.
Right.
Picking stuff. Movies are communal, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
Only when you get to the home does it start to become piecemeal. Even in the best examples, more than one person watches in your home. But when you're on a computer, it's you.
Right.
That's not necessarily the movie experience. So there's no reason why the logic should be that you're going, what happened to the music business is inherently going to happen to the movie business,
right?
Unless you make it self-fulfilling prophecy.
Well, I assume the whole piracy canard is a canard. That they constantly continue to talk about piracy like that's the only issue in the business.
Well, piracy is stupid. There's always been piracy.
And there's really no way to stop it in the countries that it really is popular.
And guess what? You know, if your business is still at record levels, or close to record levels, then piracy is having impact, but it's not killing your business. So why would you kill your business to stop piracy?
Right.
And you know, one of the companies was, you know, I mean, the beginning of DVDs, and somebody, I read one of the things was complaining, and even went back to something I'd said at the time, which is holding back off a DVD, only for one reason, which was copy protection. The studios didn't care enough about copy protection then,
right?
Because they're saying, oh, it's always piracy. Now it's just an excuse, I think, to justify decisions.
Yeah,
piracy is going to go on, and there are ways to tamper it down. There's probably no ways to stop it other than spend your time in Congress.
Right.
Get legislatures.
Well, it's fascinating to me that like 4 or 5 years ago, whenever it was, we had the screener ban year at the Academy, that, you know, in the last two years, now they've started sending things in the mail and that nothing gets signed for anymore because there's a pain.
Right.
And it's such a priority that they now leave things on your doorstep without, you know, that anybody can pick up.
Again, it's not, there's no, and I can just tell you from 20 years of working inside studios, I can't tell you anybody, any management that I work for that cared.
Right.
At all. So that's just not the case. And you don't shoot yourself because you have the flu. You don't, you know. Yes, it's a problem. It's not, you're going to get sick. You're going to have things happen to you, but you don't, that doesn't mean you change everything. You don't change everything you're doing unless you have a better way of doing it.
Well, it strikes me that they don't quite know what the illness is. I think that they're still, to me, the biggest thing that happened was all that DVD money started coming in and they spent it all. Instead of saving it for a rainy day or making it into profit or whatever, they spent it all. And now the cost of making a movie and distributing a movie is so insanely high that now that they have to cut it by 30-40% just to be in business because they've lost that on DVD in the last few years.
But they're not.
They're not.
You have two problems. I think you're entirely correct. And again, it's the history of the business.
Yeah.
Every time there's windfall profit, the profit's given away. So
agents
one,
are very
that's kind of stupid by its own self. But that happens. You can't stop stupidity from going on. So you spend more and more and more and more. Mm-hmm. There's no reason to spend more and more and more and more. You know, in marketing, there's, you know, saturation levels. Once you hit saturation, everything you spend is excess.
Mm-hmm.
Make you feel good because they spent that much money, which is the only reason why people spend as much as they're spending. And the making of movies is all you're doing is throwing away your profit. And if you look at the drop in DVD or video, Blu-ray, however you want to do it, two things. One, the introduction of Blu-ray, which is one of my pet things, of introduction of Blu-ray in the middle of the worst recession in any of our lifetimes is like insane. Just completely like, what are you thinking? Mm-hmm. You're gonna resell all your library for a moderately better technology, which is, I don't know why. And then two sorry, I lost the thought.
Well, the fascinating thing about Blu-ray right now is that, I mean, I actually went and walked into horrifyingly, a Blockbuster the other day and walked into a Best Buy and a Target, and they've all not only cut most of their DVD sections, Blu-ray included, but the Blu-ray pricing has now come down to where DVD was a year ago.
Right, which...
I mean, it's not even like they're getting a premium on Blu-ray anymore.
Well, you can't.
Yeah.
Because to most people, forget video files or audio files or any of files. You know,
the 2% the media writes about all day long.
Right. Those people don't matter. I mean, they introduce things and they're important, but they don't matter. What matters is, you know, the zillions of people in the world. Mm-hmm. If I show you a Blu-ray and I show you a DVD, most people would say it's not significant enough to spend the money on.
Right.
So if you want to introduce the next technology just because it's next technology, then they should be priced at the same price point.
Right.
And worse, because they felt like this is back to self-fulfilling prophecy. The Blu-ray was going to take over, which was, you know, I don't know what they were smoking, but whatever you're doing, you're saying Blu-ray is going to take over. So now the DVD is not worth anything. So you drop, your price points and you put them in garbage bins. Mm-hmm. So you're, when you go into Walmart, you're at $5.99 or $3.99
for more than one movie.
And now I got Titanic for $3.99. Now I'm going to introduce Titanic for $29 or $26 or right. whatever it is. Well, why in heaven's name should I pay that money for this when this is just almost as good?
Yeah.
So and why in heaven's name would I not have the brains to think, oh, eventually this price erosion is going to make this untenable and I'm right. going to have to come down? As opposed to find a price point that works, hold it, don't allow your product to be degraded.
Mm-hmm. Well, do you, it's one of the fascinating things in this whole conversation is the idea of of ongoing, the idea that the studios, the industry, sets the agenda as opposed to having the agenda set for them by the public. There's this constant refrain of, well, the audience wants it, so let's give it to them. Mm-hmm. When in fact, it seems to me like the entire business forever has been based on the idea of giving the audience what the industry wants to give them, when they want to give it to them. I mean, obviously things have to be popular, but it's the idea that somehow the public controls the price points or the new technology or home entertainment versus theatrical, mm-hmm. seems suicidal inherently.
Yeah. I don't know that, having been inside of it for so long, I don't know that the studios feel they're controlling anything. So and everybody's such a different organism. But if you were paying attention, I mean, to me, one of those jobs is to read where the audience is, what the audience is doing. And, mm-hmm. and so when you said the drop of DVD, the drop of DVD is more pronounced on the biggest movies than on anything.
Right.
And then you go, okay, well, why? That drop is because those movies, by and large, aren't any good because they're manufactured events.
Right.
So when you say, are you listening to the public? No, I'd say not. The public has changed demographically just by usage things. Mm-hmm. So who's the highest use? What segment of the population uses the internet the most?
Right.
Younger.
Kids. Yeah.
Right. Young males, mm-hmm. higher than even young females. Who are movies mostly made for?
Young
males. Okay, that doesn't track, does it?
Right.
There's some illogic to that, and mm-hmm. because now you've made your movies bigger, and you read it and everything, and everybody now talks all the talk, marketing talk of four quadrants and stuff like that. So now you're making a movie for maybe incorrectly, you're making a movie for young males, mm-hmm. but now I got to get it to be for all quadrants, so now I'm not going to make it for young males.
Right. You mean Natalie Portman and Thor?
You're trying to get, well, you're doing things that have nothing to do with creative content.
Right.
So if I'm targeting a harder to get consumer, young male,
right.
on the go, I have to make it compelling for that young male to go. I'm not going to make something that's soft and warm and fuzzy. I'm not making PG-13 all the time.
Right.
If I've got an R-rated movie, again, Sucker Punch, let Sucker Punch be whatever it is.
Right.
But if Sucker Punch was made for the audience that it seems like it was made for, which was a young male audience, mm-hmm. then it should probably be an R-rated movie.
Right.
I have nothing to do with it. You could pick any one of 10 movies.
Well, the funny thing about that movie, for instance, as an example, is that it seems to be chasing teenage girls, and yet chased teenage girls away, and yet was too expensive
right.
to just sell to the Geek Boys, which maybe do $30, $40 million
right.
happily. Instead, right. they're going to do $30, $40 million and lose their shirts.
But that's the inherent dilemma that I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Now you're making it four quadrants. You're trying to bring in an audience that isn't natural to you. So when I did X-Men, opening it in a concentration camp, when I was leaving Fox, they called it my $70 million art film, because mm-hmm. it's dark and you're not going to get young anything
right.
for it. And it's no, it's a movie. It's
right.
telling a story. The alienation that the story ultimately, to me, what X-Men's about is alienation. That will resonate inside the younger audiences. It resonated mm-hmm. more than that, but. It resonates because it's honest and it's true and it's not trying to be a wolf in sheep's clothing.
Right.
It is exactly what it is. And I think when you try and soften something up, I'll take another one of mine on Something About Mary. Mm-hmm. We didn't try and make it work for young girls. I thought it was, we made a very, very successful movie for young guys in that case.
Right.
It was R-rated. there wasn't anything. I never expected an older audience to ever go to it. Mm-hmm. One of the shocks to me was, you know, when I got a call from my in-laws who are very conservative, and they thought it was the funniest movie ever, and I'm like embarrassed that they saw it, because I thought, oh, they're going to start on me about, you know, the sexual content in the movie.
Right.
But it wasn't. And the argument inside the studio, people were trying to cut off the edges to make it more palatable to a wider audience. To me, those are the things that are the ones that are, you're saying, what's happening in theatrical, what's happening in the film business? You're slicing your own throat for this to make films bigger.
Right.
And the more expensive they are, the more you have to pull in wider audiences, and the more you're not fulfilling anything to anybody. You're essentially making a movie for no one.
Well, can you know? I mean, it's the old joke at Peter Guber's favorite story about, you know, why not just make the good ones?
That's what everybody does to you. But no, can you? You don't know who it is. You know that if you make a good movie, you know that it has an audience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my thought is always, it has to be an event to an audience specifically.
Mm-hmm.
Making a movie for everybody is a hard, you know, hard thing to do. You don't know. That to me is more nebulous. I don't know what's everything.
When you're making it a couple years off the zeitgeist, also, you're kind of like thinking about what the audience might want in this broader sense, and then 2 years later, you're offering
it. Yes, a war. You start a war, and all of a sudden, terrorist movie is like, whoa.
Yeah.
You know, not that that would ever be a big movie, but you're, the current, whatever's going on in the world changes people's impressions. Do they want to laugh? Do they want to escape? Do they want to be scared? You know, whatever that feeling is, that zeitgeist changes by what's happening out in the broader scope of things. So yes, you're always, because the manufacturing process, making a movie, mm-hmm. you are almost always behind the curve. What you're never behind the curve on is it a good story?
Right.
You may not know where it all goes. You know, nobody would have said Titanic would have been, you know, right. That big. You know, I always thought it would be a very successful movie. I never thought it'd be at the level that you got people to go that never went. You know, I knew Something About Mary was a hit movie. I didn't think it was as big a movie as it became. You know, sometimes you think a movie is going to do this kind of business and it doesn't do that business, but you sort of know you have a good movie, and once you have a good movie, the audiences will seek you out because there are so few of them.
Well, I always think a few weeks after a movie opens, you find out the studio actually knew it sucked. After months of telling you how great it was, they knew the whole time.
Well, most of the time you do. You know that, you know, but once you've made it, you have nowhere to go but forward. And again, back to the VOD. If that movie sucks and you get one night and the word of mouth is so quick, essentially you're done.
Right.
You've now spent $200 million to make a movie that has no second usage. You know, when right now, if you fail in this market, if you don't fail all the way, so theatrical, you can make that clunker that doesn't really work for $200 million, you're still getting a large portion of your money back. But the bigger thing is you're earning money in every subsequent market.
Right.
You take away all the subsequent markets and you fail here, you essentially, I think, that's where your first question, the cataclysm.
So your feeling is that the additional windows might collapse, could collapse all the windows.
There's
so many windows that there are no windows.
The problem isn't the theatrical. The problem is to the subsequent windows.
But as you get to that, as you start doing a 6-week window and a 12-week window and a 16-week window,
you're impinging on the first window, but you're killing the other windows.
Right.
So right now you can't sell a movie to the network.
Right.
Essentially, you know, again, a few years ago, when, you know, we sold Independence Day for $70 million.
Right.
That now is a zero.
Yeah.
So
when you can't
kill
this.
You can kill those things behind you. It's harder to kill the first thing, but you keep weakening it, and you kill everything behind you, and you've actually destroyed the model that has worked in film without a replacement model that shows any signs of making sense.
So do you think there's just the assumption that a replacement model will happen because something like DVD happened or VHS happened, so it's going to happen again even though it doesn't make a lot of sense?
Yeah, I think that's exactly it. I think that, you know, okay, we're not going to let Apple own everything like in music. We'll be the owners of the content, so we'll drive it. And I don't know that they're that's the model for boobies. Mm-hmm. And music didn't have subsequent windows and didn't,
right.
You know, it's a very kind of weird, very unique, you know, way of doing business. But when only 20% of your money comes out of theatrical, only 12% or something like that comes out of U.S. theatrical, or
right.
10%. So only 10% of revenue that you're making is where everybody's, you know, and all anybody writes about
right.
is 10% of your business.
But it does seem to drive everything else.
It does. It establishes value. So when you did, okay, I make this movie that, you know, 3 weeks later you find out this. There's
right.
no 3 weeks later in the future if
right.
you don't have it.
Yeah.
There isn't like the second week of Soul Surfer.
Yeah.
That drops 28%. Why? Because it's a pretty good movie.
Yeah.
You know, and
well, and it also started with a smaller number.
And audiences find it. Well, but it's more word of mouth.
Yes. But I mean, the word of mouth is good. So you're actually building an audience at the same time. You're not starting at such a high level that.
You can start at a high level. Certainly, the higher the level, the more you shoot it out of the gate.
Yeah.
The more ultimately you're not doing anything. And
right.
marketing wise, the problem that the studios face is you spend now $80 million, $100 million, whatever it is, $60 million to market a movie, and,
right.
and 6 months later people don't remember it. There's a reason for that. One, it's not very good.
Mm.
Two, because you're jet propelling things, there's no stick, there's no
right.
adherence to it. So, you know, let's move it up so we get the value of what we spent. That inherently, if you move one movie up, that one movie will benefit,
right?
Because it sticks out. If you move the entire
Everything.
Industry up, it's the same 6 months later,
right.
3 months later, 6 weeks later. You can go now and I could even probably do it with you. What movies opened 6 weeks ago?
I only know because of VOD, actually.
Okay.
The Adam Sandler movie.
Okay,
the,
there you go. Okay, so you're probably one of five people
right.
that I could do the,
yeah.
go on the street and ask.
Yeah.
6 weeks ago, somebody just spent $60 to $100 million to market a movie. Tell me one of the movies
right.
that opened during January.
Right.
I've got, in this town, you probably can't get five people that could answer
right.
that question. So it's just the nature of the beast. So moving it up isn't going to help you.
Right. And the 6 week thing is, the question I would have is, does the actual literal ability to see the movie, if you can see the Adam Sandler movie in 6 weeks, does it actually, do most of the people who might someday consume that movie outside of a theater, even if they're not going to spend the $30 on premium VOD, which most of them aren't, I'd say,
right.
do they now just think that everything is available in 6 weeks and they don't
yes.
have to worry about it, regardless
right.
of the fact that there's one level that's like this and it costs this and this costs that? Are they still just basically going to wait till it's up for the cheapest possible, you know, way to see it and just watch it?
Well, what tends to happen is actually worse than that. Most
right.
people don't even know when things are released. They don't
right.
understand. They think it's quicker. They think it's longer. But if
Which
you
less and less now with the DVR and everything else, we have no sense of time.
Right. But the biggest problem you have is that if somebody didn't make the buy decision,
right.
if they didn't go to see it in a theater, they tend not to, you're tending to
again.
Sell to the same people.
Yeah.
All the way through the lifespan. If you know, you did see it a rap at some movie, you know,
right.
you do a movie that I didn't see in the theater, for some reason, you know, unless I heard it was really good, then, and I just was not, you know, I was too busy and it disappeared and
right.
whatever happened and I didn't see it, that may be a movie I'd catch up on. If it was the Adam Sandler movie, which I didn't decide to go to, even though they spent all that money,
right.
then I'm probably not going to
yeah.
decide to watch it in any one of those life forms.
And if you're an Adam Sandler fan, you're probably the person buying the DVD. If anybody's buying the DVD, you're already invested in probably going to the movie
right.
theater and you're buying the DVD.
What I always found is you tend to preach to the choir.
Mm-hmm.
The same people there, when you're selling in DVD or Blu-ray or VOD or cable or whatever, you're selling to the people who saw it or had a predisposition to see it.
Mm-hmm.
And the people who said, I don't see Adam Sandler, they ain't going to see Adam Sandler.
So unless you have the King's Speech and you go VOD the week of Academy Awards.
Right. But
which
then
is its own marketing campaign.
right. King's Speech doesn't exist. That's
right.
the whole point. King's Speech, if the model that's being pushed right now, if it's VOD replaces, if it has a cataclysmic effect,
right.
hurts theatrical, kills the aftermarkets, essentially there is no King's Speech in 5 years.
Hmm. And what about the idea of something like Harry Potter?
Harry Potter will be Harry Potter. Harry Potter will make a lot of money.
Right.
Harry Potter in the future may make more money than it makes today because there'll be fewer expenses.
Right. But if you have the pre-sold...
If you're a pre-sold commodity, you're going to do great. Your big, known commodities are going to be extremely successful.
And the funny thing is, though, like Harry Potter, I keep on saying, is the end of the franchise as we know it, because it seems to be like last franchise that a studio is going to pay for itself. I mean, I don't think there is another franchise picture that's been made since Potter or in the last couple of years that hasn't been a shared expense movie with a funding corporation.
Right, which is, if that's true, you're tracking closer than I am. To me, the business always worked by owning, you know, by taking your chances.
Right.
One, not spending as much money as people are spending. You know, as I always say, with Titanic, we got to the $200 million by accident. We didn't get there by design. And I thought it, and we publicized, let it be publicized, how much it cost, because I was trying to say, be careful, because in a failure, if the movie wasn't as good as it was, it would have lost money.
Right.
If the movie was good, it would have lost money. The movie happened to defy the law of gravity, and everybody followed, saying, well, look how much money you can make. You know, the truth is, you can never lose as much as you can make in a movie business. Mm. So you need those movies that do work to pay for all the other movies. And if you're splitting things and you're co-financing things, I'd say it's probably a harder movie, harder to make the business work as a business.
Well, the studios seem to be getting out of the funding business as much as they can.
Well, I think everybody's
Batman, everything else has been split.
Right.
Superman will be split.
Yeah. Well, I think people don't like the movie business. And I always felt that's just because you applied yourself wrong.
Should we like it? I mean, when you have a quarter like this first quarter this year, everybody's, you know, the sky is falling for certain people, or claiming they're saying the sky is falling. Isn't in some ways this kind of what the business is? I mean, we don't have any blockbusters. We have a lot of solid singles and doubles out there that we don't usually always have.
Well, I think the problem, if you're a studio, to me it's a slate. To make all your movies big means you're betting on that you have those things that should be big.
Right.
You know, I call them ersatz blockbusters. So they're not really, you know, you're 10th tier down on your comic book. Mm-hmm. Your 10th comic book company down.
Right.
You know, and saying, oh, comic book movies work. And then to compete, I have to make it this expensive. There's... Instead of being this kind of animated film, I have to be this kind of animated film. And, you know, so what you're doing is two things. One is there's so many of them that the ideas start getting muddled.
Right.
So they're not real blockbusters. It's not Harry Potter. It's, you know, to use my Fight Club, it's a copy of a copy of a copy.
Right.
So now you have derivative material that's trying to be made like it's the original. And then two is there's so many of them that it's hard for even the original to stand out. So you're spending more to get less out of it.
Yeah.
So you're inherently creating a business that doesn't completely work for you. Instead of saying that every year I could come up with two very good pictures that should be huge.
Right.
And I'm going to invest my money in those two big pictures, and now the rest of them I should make to look work to be a big picture, again, my view was to make a big picture for this audience.
Right.
Not to make a big picture for this audience, because if I'm making it for this audience, I'm spending more, I'm doing more, and I'm watering it down. But I can get a big hit movie out of a young male audience. I can get a big hit movie out of an older audience.
Right.
If I'm following demographics, I should be making movies absolutely counter to what the studios are doing right now, which is I should be making older movies.
Right. And people were talking about Insidious and Soul Surfer this quarter. Those are both niche movies.
That were big, they're events for an audience.
Specific, very specific audience.
But, and they're made for price. They'll make money.
Yeah.
And if I did that 10 times a year, 15 times a year, then I'm making really good profits and I'm not risking everything for an all or nothing release.
Meanwhile, we have five big animated movies in, you know, 12 weeks this quarter.
I'd say that's a recipe for disaster. For somebody, and you have to divide up the pie.
And is there a sense? I mean, do people just lose their minds and go, okay, well, Ice Age 3 made so much money in first quarter two years ago that we're going to throw every animated movie there is in 5 weeks?
Why wouldn't we? Why wouldn't we compete?
Well, but you compete with five movies. At some point, you have to be hurt. Well,
I think they're thinking I'm going to win. I don't think you ever think I'm not going to win. I mean, the copycat nature of the business is always that way.
Yeah.
I mean, in some ways, when it created Searchlight, Searchlight was a copy of Miramax at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And when if you look at the first few years of Searchlight, you know, it was a copy, and we weren't successful doing it. It wasn't until we changed what Searchlight was
right. That
Searchlight, once it started becoming its own identity, it really started to work. And mm-hmm. then what happened? Everybody said, whoa, now there's two of them that work.
Right.
We should all have one. And all of a sudden you had seven, you know, these dependent studios,
yeah.
you know, and canceling each other out. All of a sudden, you know, like 3 years ago, there were so many arty films less mainstream pictures, right. Just call them that way, that they canceled each other out.
When their budgets started flying up also, which is the other.
Two problems, which is the same thing as animation. So
right. When
you started Fox Animation, did Ice Age, it was really, when we started Fox Animation with Anastasia,
yeah. There
was only Disney.
Right.
Then there was Disney and DreamWorks. Then Disney was doing more and DreamWorks was doing more.
Right.
Then there were, you know, now you've got one and now somebody else starts. And all of a sudden, you get to the point where now you're in the five releases in 8 weeks or whatever it is.
Talking about
different
Anastasia.
Different environment.
Talking about Anastasia and Fight Club, I feel like we're torturing you in the conversation.
Yeah.
So does VOD, the $30 premium VOD, naturally end up being the $20 premium VOD if it doesn't take off? Is that part of the deterioration that's coming 6 months from now?
No, if it takes off, it'll be that.
Huh.
There's an inevitability the prices won't stay there.
So the price will come down even more so if it's successful?
Yes.
Because there'll be more competition between the studios to...
And somebody will do it, say, let me do it for this, you start becoming dependent on the market, and the market starts hitting a lull, and somebody says, oh, let's do some research, and the public's saying it's too much money
right. For
this movie, so you discount that movie, and all of a sudden somebody says, well, I can't have my big movie suffer to their littler movie. And
right. It's
just a natural price point. I mean, I go back to when video, forget DVD, when VHS came into market, and I had nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. You know, I was a young pup at the time, and they were I was at Paramount, and then Paramount released Star Trek or one of those, you know, to sell, and mm-hmm. they were selling it at 39 or something like that.
Right.
Or 59 or something, mm-hmm. you know, some obscenely high price point.
Right.
And it worked to a certain level. And then you got it down to 29.
Right.
But 29 is really not a friendly price point. So
yeah. Then,
you know, the markets were assigned to me when I was at Disney, and you start studying it going, okay, well, there's a price point that it starts to become a mass media.
Right.
Which was really a $20 price point. So, you know, you're 59 in 3 years is 29. In the other 2 years, it's 19.
Right.
And now it's $3.99.
And that's the inevitable. Competitive urge.
I always said it's a business defined by your stupidest competitor.
Mm.
So somebody's going to do something. You have two choices: ignore it or match it.
And that's what people thought. I mean, I think maybe 6 months ago about the VOD thing was because everybody had been on the Fight Club pricing thing about three or four years ago. It was a hot moment, and then they just decided it wasn't going to work. Realized it was a bad idea and got out of it. And then maybe 6 months ago, everybody was like, well, it's just Warner Brothers and Disney that are pushing this thing right now. And then all of a sudden, this all happened a few weeks ago.
But I think right now there's more common agendas in the corporations. They're all, mm-hmm. again, to me, and I don't know if this is true, but I would assume that when you go to Disney, which has got, you know, Apple behind it, mm-hmm. and Warner's, which is, you know, makes more of its money in cable and everything else. Mm-hmm. I just think the, you know, Comcast now, and I don't think there's anything malicious.
Right.
I don't think there's enough argument inside the corporations,
mm-hmm.
to say, wait a minute, you're trading a maybe for essentially the underpinning of what we do for a living.
Right. And do you think it doesn't really matter ultimately the corporations?
I think the right argument back, and nobody's, I mean, they're not stupid people, they're smart people.
Mm-hmm.
you know, and you'd certainly find ways to find, you know, is this, if you're going to make a shift,
right,
make a shift when you know something, not when you think something.
But I mean, it's already a low margin business. The value.
Well, it's a low margin business because people made it a low margin business.
Yeah.
It wasn't a low margin business when I was running Fox. We made good money. Fox, I think, still makes good money. I think so, Fox is still one of the most profitable studios.
And yet the most beat up.
Doesn't matter. That's a different thing. When you say, when you're just talking profit.
So the corporations care whether these companies exist, but if the whole landscape changes.
Well, I think if you said to anybody, any of the corporations, your $10 billion investment, mm-hmm. your $10 billion property, you can let a tsunami hit it and wipe it out.
Right.
Or you can build a firewall and look for ways, not to have it, you're not going to stop things completely, but you know,
right.
how do I gain control of it and how do I use something in my own way? I would think smartness will always win. Hmm. But well, you have to have a very healthy debate.
Right. Well, there has to be an evolution. I mean, it feels like there has to, because I do think that post-theatrical, which is funny since 20 years ago it didn't exist, but that post-theatrical is going to change. I mean, mm-hmm. the idea of everything, whenever you want it is real, mm-hmm. And they'll eventually have to adjust to it. I personally think subscription model is inevitable.
Right.
But whatever it ends up being, they're going to have to adjust to that. But the theatrical does seem to be the one thing that's kind of a business where it is a unique opportunity. Mm-hmm. And even if it is 10 or 15% of the overall revenue, it seems like it'll be even more important as time goes on. And it's the only place where you can get a per person price to go to a movie.
Well, it's two things. One, it's the only place you can get out of the house to see something.
Right.
So it's the only place where movies work the way they're designed, which is, mm-hmm. you know, they're not pieces of art.
Right.
They're not paintings to go stare at by yourself. They're not music where you put on your headset and turn off from the world. You're
right.
Actually you go see a comedy in a screening room.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't very funny, you know?
Right.
I mean, it has to be really good, which is not most movies.
Yeah.
It has to be really good. Or a scary movie, you know, can be mm-hmm. stupid.
Yeah.
Versus the person next to you, mm-hmm. you know, jumping, you know,
yeah.
grabbing your, reaching out to some stranger doesn't know mm-hmm. you because they're scared, you know, shitless, you mm-hmm. know? You know, the laughter, the scare, the, you know, anything. Amazement, the awe of watching an Avatar. It's a different, you know, 3D, that, you know, seeing Avatar in 3D, like mm-hmm. in, you know, is pretty amazing, and you're sharing it with people all around mm-hmm. you. Take that away and you're changing what's being done.
And something like Avatar or Titanic in its day confuse everybody and think that it's either too easy or that's the target, or it may a reasonable target, or that.
Well, they take, I think, again, to me, the mistakes of those are, what are they? That, you know, that anything can be that big is harder to do, I think.
Well, those numbers movies, are just so beyond everything else.
But that would,
stunning.
To me, the shame of the business is, you know, from Avatar, from Titanic to Avatar is 13 or 14 years. And
right.
14 years, and I had it with people saying to me on Titanic, you know, even my mother went to see it at the time, and
right.
you know, she hadn't gone to a movie in 30 years. You know, people mm-hmm. were doing that. I would get it. It wasn't, you know, everybody talked about the young girls going over and over. It wasn't the young girls going over and over again. It was the expanded the audience.
Right.
You brought people back to movies that stopped going to movies because movies had no appeal to them
mm-hmm.
because they weren't made for them. I'd say that's a lesson of Titanic, not how do I get to $1 billion. You know.
Right.
Which, now let's just spend more money to make these things bigger and bigger. It wasn't the Titanic was big. Titanic told a story that people liked, that
right.
emotionally created a response in people that they can't get anywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they fell in love with the movie. So that's what you should be emulating, not how do I get, I mean, I'm not gonna get as good as Dark Knight is.
Right.
And I think it's brilliant. So.
Right.
As good as Dark Knight is, you can't get Titanic out of Dark Knight.
Yeah.
You know, it's inherently a different life form.
Yeah.
So where are the movies that are going to play to the older audience, which are so good that it brings in a younger audience?
And trying to expand that audience by technology as opposed to filmmaking is inherently the backwards thinking.
Yes.
So are you?
I would say.
So are you hopeful?
Well, to me, there's always great films and great filmmakers, which you want. I mean, I love Chris Nolan just for the fact that he used his power from Dark Knight to make Inception.
Right.
So to me, when you have somebody like that, there's always hope.
And then one. I mean, that's the thing that's so amazing about it to me is that it was one of those movies that was made because of power, not because they wanted to make the movie so much.
No.
And it still hit the jackpot.
Right. And to me, those are, as long as there's, you know, I call them transformational movies. There's movies that you can affect an audience. You make filmmakers, you create new film audiences. Mm. You know, everybody says, okay, in the case of, you know, of today, everybody's doing multitasking, you know. Mm-hmm. Nobody's got time to go to a movie, and then you get an Avatar and everybody goes, you know. And you get and I don't know if it was true, but it has to be true of Avatar. I know it's true of Titanic, and the people who like it went back over and over again.
Right.
They watched it and they bought it in video, you know. Mm-hmm. It's still the best-selling video of all time now, I guess. And they watched it on television. They watched it on a network, which is old in network.
Yeah.
And they watch it on cable when it's on HBO or Showtime. And they they watch it when it's on reruns on whatever cable network it's sold to.
Right.
So there's when you do great things, there's great things follow. What you don't want is to have people shoot the entire business in the foot.
Yeah.
To me, the danger and why do this is, I mean, I think there's a danger. There's no open debate. You know, we're doing this.
Right.
And God bless, it's, you know.
Well, it's hard to get anything through. I mean, ultimately, as we've seen with our president and others in the past, that if you want to have a real discussion, people think you're weak and people think you're not, make it hard for you to go where you need to go.
Right.
So in some ways, I think the studio's tricking the exhibitors by not telling them was the only way to do this. I think what they're doing is stupid, personally, but, you know, it's like, it's this weird thing about, and I also think that the media is exactly the wrong group to have the conversation with, because it's everybody who's in the age group that goes to see the movies the least and has the least time, the least money, the least opportunity.
It becomes a soundbite too. Yeah. Also, it's very easy to say, okay, it happened to music, it's gonna happen to movies. And I think that probably, that comparison has probably done more disservice to movies than anything.
You
read it in the comments, the anonymous comments that the internet now has fostered. People won't speak their own minds.
No.
You know, it's like, let me say whatever I want to say, except I'll say it with, you know, some and not some.
No, you're one of the few people who ever, when you were in a position of running a studio, would actually say what you thought also.
Right. Well, everybody get pissed at me again. I mean, if it's not in my interest to have everybody pissed at me.
Right.
You know, that's not what I'm there for. I care about the business I'm in. I love movies. I want movies to survive. I want them to survive 50 years from now, you know, it's not in my lifetime, it's the next lifetime. So if you don't, and you just allow things to happen, then, you know, then you're part of the problem.
Yeah. So I always say that the media side of it, like, you know, 45-year-old men with two kids and a mortgage and a $50,000 a year job or $70,000 a year job are the people who want everything on home video, and they want it when they want it, and they see the ads and they care and they want to see the movie. Understandable.
Right.
But it doesn't mean that the studio should give it to them because they asked for it.
Right.
Because they're the people who aren't spending money on movies ever.
And my guess is they won't spend it on the...
Right.
If it's a download because they're too busy.
Yeah.
Well, they're not your audience.
And if your cable bill's already $100, I think that first cable bill that comes in, it's $160.
Right.
Somebody craps their pants and, you know, it's over.
Right. My first job out of college was actually pay-per-view. Was one of the first two pay-per-view systems in the country. And it wasn't subscription, it was just pure pay-per-view. And sure enough, exactly what you said, the first month or 2 months, our best customers were starting to disconnect because they went haywire. And they spent $150. This is when cable was probably, or pay TV was early, so it was probably $20 or whatever. So instead of being a $20 bill, they had a $160 bill or a $300. We had some people that watched, you know, like, okay, get a life.
Yeah.
But, you know, that will happen. You watch three movies at $30, you got another $100 on a $100 bill. And in today's economy, that ain't going to happen.
Yeah. No, the market seems to be the market. And then certain events just expand the market.
Yes. And if you were trying to make your business better, control your cost, make better movies. Not a third thing. Better movies, control your costs.
So we're down to two.
Do that, the business gets inherently better.